Dann kommen wir jetzt zum ersten großen Block über Marktübersichten, in Richtung der Kunststoffe, der Fasern, der Anwendungen und so weiter. Wir haben heute eine Keynote-Session und drei Vorträge. In der Keynote-Session wird Herr Dr. Jürgen Büchner und Herr Sven Anders von der IKB Deutschen Industriebank über Trends in der globalen Rohmaterialindustrie oder Trends in the Global Raw Material Market berichten. Ich möchte gerne bitten, dass Sie nach vorne kommen, und danach haben wir sicherlich schon die ersten großen Fragen.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks a lot for the invitation to give you a brief overview concerning the global commodity markets. I'm Heinz-Jürgen Büchner from IKB. We are founded in the same year as AVK in 1924, and we are a commercial bank. We do only, we have a lot of medium-sized customers, even from the plastics industry, from the German automotive sector or the European industry. And therefore, we do also monthly commodity, short-term commodity price outlooks, where I am responsible together with my team as head of industrials automotive, and my colleague Sven Anders is responsible in our team for the chemical industry. So I hope, yeah, it works. At first, let us give a short overview concerning economic environment, and then a look on the trends in the markets for crude oil and natural gas. Then we have a look on the plastics markets, and at the end, we have some remarks concerning future challenges in the energy, concerning energy and sustainability in our oil industry. Let us first start with a quick look on the economic surrounding. 1920 was a very bad year. Worldwide, with the exception of China, every country has a shutdown, and we saw a drop in economic activity. Only China shows a little growth of 2.3%. In the current year, at the beginning of the year 2021, we were all very optimistic that we could compensate the drop in the last year. And at first, for Germany, the forecast was plus 6%. Meanwhile, it's less than 3%, which we expect. And in every country of the world, the numbers came down. Within Europe, also we saw a very sharp drop down in Great Britain as a result of the Brexit, in addition to a strong pandemic. And the strongest growth from the bigger nations will be seen in India. The growth rate in China will be a little bit less, but China is much more important, and therefore China is again the locomotive for the worldwide activity in the current year. Last year, we saw a very sharp drop in the production of light vehicles. Only around 75 million light vehicles were produced, and for the current year, at the beginning of the year, most research institutes and even the industry by themselves were very optimistic. They expected a recovery to around 84 million light vehicles in the current year. But, excuse me, times changed dramatically. We saw a shortage of chip production for the automotive industry at the beginning of the year, because in last year, the automotive producers ordered less chips when they saw that their production the last year came down. And there are only a few bigger chip producers worldwide, mainly located in the Asian markets. And they changed their production into the production of iPhones and similar products. And at the beginning of the year, they have no capacity to fulfill higher orders. Then we saw a blockade of the Suez Channel, and on this ship, Evergreen, there were a lot of ships, and these ships came into a harbor at the end of June, because directly after the blockade was finished, the ship was fixed in an Egyptian harbor. Then in April, Renesas, the worldwide biggest producer of ships for the automotive industry, had a fire in their production plants. 23 of their production lines were shut down, and they started with full production at September of the current year. Therefore, the forecasts for the production of the German, the European, and the global automotive industry were reduced only to a similar level since last year, but we see a strong forecast in the next 2 years. The global construction industry does very well, even in Europe in the last year. We saw a slight reduction in Western Europe production levels. We saw also a production reduction in Eastern Europe, but worldwide, the global construction industry showed a strong growth, mainly driven by China. Why? Because China started with subsidies for the construction sector in the middle of 2020. They want to compensate their industry of the results of the shutdown in the first quarter, and they did it very, very successful. Even Europe started subsidy programs to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic, but most of these programs started in the current year, not in the last year. And during the next years, we are very optimistic that the global construction industry show further growth, mainly driven in the emerging markets, but even in Western Europe, even in Germany, we will see further growth. And a lot of plastic will be used in the construction sector. Now, what is the development in the global markets for crude oil and for natural gas? Let me have at first a look on the situation in the current and the next year, and especially in the current year and the current quarter. We forecast an oil demand of 99.5 million, million barrel per day in the fourth quarter of 2021. The non-OPEC supply is at the moment estimated with 65.1 million barrel per day. Therefore, an OPEC supply of around 34.4 million barrels per day is necessary. A part of the supply will come from natural gas liquids, and the OPEC announced for the fourth quarter a production of 5.15 million barrels per day. Therefore, we need at the moment in this quarter until the end of the year on average a production of 29.2 million barrels per day. But we will not see these production numbers in the whole year. Why? Because in October we had only a production level of 27.45 million barrels per day. OPEC announced to increase their production level for November by 0.4 million barrels per day and another 0.4 million barrels per day in December, starting with December. That means that we have an undersupply in the current quarter. We will see a further increase in the oil demand in the next year, and we will see another increase in the OPEC, non-OPEC production. The situation in the next year will be more easier than in the current quarter. As a result of this undersupply in the current quarter, we will see a sharp reduction in inventories, mainly in the United States. You saw it in the last months that the inventories for crude oil came down, but even in some other regions, the oil production, the oil inventories came dramatically down. You see on the upper chart the reduction in crude oil stocks in the United States. And as a result, we saw a sharp increase during the current year in our oil price forecast. It's the level for Brent oil, and we have a forecast that until the end of the year, we will see a fluctuation between 82 and 84 US dollars per barrel Brent. Yesterday it was a little bit lower, that's right, but we will see a lower oil price, not a significant lower oil price, only in the next year, in the second half, not at the first half of the next year. And the main reason for this is that we see a limited production coming to an increasing demand and reducing stocks. Also, in the market for natural gas, we see a tremendous price increase. This is a so-called cross-border price Germany, Grenzübergangspreis Deutschland, for you coming from the Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. And you see, starting with mid-2020, a strong price increase jumping up. And we have in Germany the situation at the moment that the inventories came tremendously down. The so-called Speichersaldo is much lower than a year ago. And that means that we have a very, very slow inventories in natural gas in Germany. In addition, the German domestic production in natural gas is also very limited. It comes down since a lot of years. Every year it's 10-12% less production in domestic production. Therefore, we need in Germany, but also in whole Western Europe, we need strong imports of natural gas. We expect that the prices will come down if the so-called Nord Stream 2 pipeline starts to bring natural gas from Russia to Western Europe and Germany. At the moment, we have heard from some political parties in Berlin that it will, and from European authorities, that deliveries will start in next year, not in the current year. Therefore, we have the situation that even the prices for natural gas will fluctuate on a very high level. We see at the moment price levels of fluctuating around 6,500 euros per terajoule. And therefore, we will see also a lot of higher prices in the next months. I give now over to Mr. Anders, and then I will come back a little bit later to you.
Very good, thank you. Good morning also from my side. Then let's jump right into the plastics markets. We've seen plastic prices rise all over the world, and especially in Europe. And that's mainly due to also in the first half of 2021, many force majeures that we had in the industry. Don't you worry, I won't go through all of them that we depicted here. That's only in the first half and only in the major supply chains that we have seen. But we had a situation in April where approximately 20% of LDPE, 25% of PVC, 30% of polypropylene and 30% of polyamide-6 capacities in Europe were offline. And at the same time, we had very high demand in China for plastics. So in the first half of 2021, we saw prices rise dramatically through the board. And we had this very uncommon cluttering of different force majeures that were called in Europe, but also in the United States with the winter storms coming through Texas. In the second half, we have seen less force majeures notifications than we had in the first half of 2021, and that's why prices also relaxed a little bit. But still significant production capacities were offline. We left out here the PVC value chain that is still mainly hurt by force majeure notifications. In the other sectors, actually, we have seen a relaxation of force majeure notifications, and we have seen improved supply and therefore put a little downward pressure on prices, which helped producers in the plastics industry. But still, prices were consolidating on a very high level compared to the years before, and especially 2020. Dr. Büchner already talked about the crude oil prices, and those crude oil prices mainly drive naphtha quotations and also the prices for basic chemicals like ethylene and propylene. They follow the oil price, and with the rising oil price that we have seen since the second half of 2020, actually those base product prices go up, and with them also the prices for basic plastics in the market rise. We have currently still tight market supply, and we have high demand from Europe, the US, and especially China. And that's why prices actually have consolidated on quite a high level. We expect those prices to still be high, but slightly come down beginning quarter number two of 2022. When we look at price developments in certain raw materials in the second half of 2021, as I've said before, we've seen a slight relaxation of prices in the third quarter until September. But now with rising oil prices and higher supply costs and also rising energy costs through the board, actually prices in October 2021 were going up again. If you look at the VCM prices here, don't be a little concerned. They are in renminbi, and if you divide them by six, then you have approximately the price that you currently pay in Europe. Polymer prices also came down in the third quarter of 2021, but also we've seen increases in those prices in October 2021 again. Based on the effects that I've mentioned before, we are still tight on supply. We have force majeures in the supply chain still. And rising energy prices, rising CO2 emission prices, rising oil prices and rising supply costs put an upward pressure on prices here again. So we expect to see quite high prices until the end of the year and throughout quarter number one in 2022, and then slight relaxations in the second quarter of next year. So if we consider all the points that we've talked about now in the plastics market, but also in the raw materials markets, then we have certain strategic questions that we see plastics producers and plastic manufacturers face today. And those are concerning the whole value chain that we have. So some points that companies might think about or that we discuss with management is if you can integrate backwards in a way that you maybe have strategic partnerships with suppliers of polymers, or you can go into joint ventures with raw plastics or basic plastics producers. Then at the same time, how can companies benefit from the strong growth that we still see in Asia and China? How do you want to position yourself in that regard? And then we expect, especially in the plastic producers market, a consolidation in the European market and in the German market especially. And that's also a question how you want to position your companies in that field as well. And then I think it's back to you.
Thank you. Yes, what are future challenges now, especially in the energy markets, and what does sustainability mean for you as plastic producers? Let me have a first look on climate protection. Climate protection drives energy costs up. You see this in the slide on the right side. Where you see the development of electricity prices in the last months. And you see a sharp jump starting from the beginning of the year. Germany has one of the highest prices, has the highest price for industrial use in Germany, in Europe. And this will not change in the next years. Why? We will stop next year nuclear energy production in Germany. The new coalition of the next government and want to stop coal power generation earlier than 2038. Probably they want to stop it in 2030. It's not clear when it will do effectively, but they try to stop it earlier. In this situation, higher in a stop of nuclear production, stop of coal production, you will see higher price jumps. The German production of renewables is, in our point of view, not sufficient to fulfill the higher energy demand in the next years. And the demand for energy will rise, especially for electricity, as a result of higher electrification in the production of light vehicles. And the demand will jump up, and we have a lower domestic production. As a result, we had to import more electricity from our neighbors. France will send us their high nuclear electricity power generation. We will get from Poland coal-produced electricity. And in my opinion, the emissions in the coal-fired power plants in Poland are higher than the emissions in the Sherman power plants fired by coal, which will shut down during the next years. So we will see higher imports, and we will see higher prices for CO2 emission certificates. This will drive also the electricity price in the next years tremendously. And not only the electricity price, it will also be a result in higher gas prices, and you will have to pay very often more for your plastics raw materials. Why? Because also the chemical industry had to pay in the medium term more for emission 2 certificates. In addition, you had to have a higher view in the next years on sustainability. At first, we will see higher regulation in the European Union. For example, we will see higher regulation for waste avoidance and for recycling activities. We will see a higher sustainability in the production process in total. For example, until now, the German OEMs, the automotive industry, started to discuss with all the suppliers how sustainable is your production. It starts at first in the metal industry. You can say, okay, the steel industry has high emission levels. But if it starts in the steel and aluminum industry, it's only a time when they ask you as plastic producers in the supply chain. And meanwhile, they asked, where do you get your raw materials? What's the CO2 footprint of these raw materials? And what is your additional CO2 footprint which comes during your production process on it? And you see, in addition, a sustainability of the whole production process. In the long term, you will have to discuss with your customers how sustainable is your own production level, or your own production process. And that will mean you have to need persons who discuss this with them. You have to hire specialized personnel, and you had to discuss with your customer how you could reduce your carbon footprint. And that's the main important thing, you had to discuss with your customers what are you willing to pay more if my production is sustainable. And that's at the moment a big problem. Okay, it's the steel industry, it's far away from you, but at the moment, the automotive suppliers, as the automotive OEMs discuss with the steel industry if they are willing to pay more for green produced steel. And at the moment, they are not willing. Yeah? That's a risk which every plastic producer, every guy from the plastics industry had to discuss in the long term with their clients. Okay. That's a short view on the prices for CO2 emission certificates. In the middle of last year, they were only at around $15 per ton. They jumped up to more than $60 in the current year. That's 4 times higher. And in the next round, surprises as numbers of CO2 certificates distributed to the industry, either steel, either chemical industry, either power generation, will be reduced. And therefore, the prices, even in the future markets, are today higher than at the current level we see it. Thanks a lot, and we are open for questions. If you are interested in our monthly short-term commodity price outlooks, feel free to contact us. You can get some from us. You had only to register the rate. We could not set you on the distribution list. Our legal department wants that you register by yourself, but we can send you a registration link.
Yeah. Thank you. Vielen Dank. Ich spreche jetzt Deutsch. Vielen Dank, Herr Büchner, Herr Anders. Das sind ja schwierige Aussichten. Also ich glaube, Sie haben eine Nuance hier natürlich hier die Kunststoffbranche adressiert. Wir sind in der Faserverbundbranche. Das heißt, wir haben auch noch die Faserkomponente. Und da kommen natürlich die logistischen Kosten noch dazu. Ich sage mal nur ein Beispiel. Glasfaser kostet in der Regel etwas um 1 Euro bis 1,20 Euro und so weiter. Wenn es aus Asien kommt, ein Container kostete damals 1.500 Dollar, jetzt 15.000 Dollar. Das heißt, der Faserpreis von Glas würde sich quasi verdoppeln dadurch. Carbonfasern ähnlich und so weiter, also auf einem anderen Niveau. Aber die Transportkosten sind enorm. Und wir haben, ähnlich wie wir das damals bei den Masken hatten, keine Produktion mehr in Europa. Und auch da muss die Branche sich umorientieren. Und deswegen denke ich auch für unsere Branche wichtig, was passiert. Gleichzeitig ist obendrauf hier die Chemiebranche hat auch bekannt gegeben, DSM, DuPont, Lanxess, Engineered Plastics sind nicht mehr strategisch, werden wahrscheinlich ausgegliedert, verkauft, gehen in andere Hände. Also unsere Industrie sieht einen großen Wandel. Der gute Punkt ist, der Demand ist da. Es werden Autos gebraucht, es werden Windkraftanlagen gebaut und so weiter, aber die Preise steigen. Generell, wie sehen Sie die Branche für Europa? Ist es eine große Chance für uns oder ist es hier eventuell ein etwas schlechteres Bild, dass wir vielleicht von Asien oder von Mittleren Osten vielleicht ein bisschen abgehängt werden.
You are not alone in several...
Deutscher, ja.
Sie sind nicht alleine hier. In vielen anderen Bereichen haben wir ähnliche Abhängigkeiten. Wenn Sie bestimmte Textilien anschauen, da wird zwar noch eine hochwertige Textilproduktion im Bereich technischer Textilien bei uns gefertigt, der Rest kommt aus Importen. Wir sind in vielen anderen Bereichen auf der Vormaterialseite etwa von Aluminium mit der Alumina-Produktion von Importen abhängig aus Asien. Bei Nickel sieht es nicht viel anders aus. Da hat mittlerweile Indonesien schon fast eine Monopolstellung. Das sind sie nicht alleine. Was ich etwas problematischer langfristig finde, wenn Produktion ausgegliedert wird, ist immer die Frage, wer übernimmt das? Gehen Sie vielleicht als strategischer Käufer rein und machen eine Rückwärtsintegration? Oder geht es an einen Finanzinvestor, der diese Produktion, sagen wir mal so, deutlich verändert? Das kann mit einer Buy-and-Build-Strategie ganz gut laufen. Das kann aber auch zu deutlichen Verlusten führen. Aber vielleicht.
Ja, ich denke, dass man in Europa als Kunststoff- oder Kunststoffverbundsindustrie dann preislich auf dem Weltmarkt wahrscheinlich in Zukunft auch nicht besser konkurrieren wird können, als das vielleicht heute der Fall ist. Es gibt natürlich die Möglichkeit, sowohl Produktionen im Ausland aufzubauen und dort die Produkte lokal zu produzieren und auch dort abzusetzen. Auf der anderen Seite ist natürlich auch spannend, was in der EU regulatorisch noch passieren wird. Ich glaube, das ganze Thema Nachhaltigkeit haben wir uns als EU sehr groß auf die Fahne geschrieben. Und uns ist ja in Diskussion, ob nicht eventuell etwas wie dieser Carbon Border Adjustment Mechanism kommt, dass Strafzölle auf CO2 schlecht CO2 nachhaltig produzierte Produkte eingeführt wird. Ich glaube, da ist gerade relativ viel in der Bewegung. Aber ich glaube, für den Weltmarkt ist es wichtig, global aufgestellt zu sein.
Okay, gut. Sind Fragen aus dem Auditorium hier? Ja, hier ist eine Frage. Können wir das mit Mikrofon machen? Haben wir noch ein Mikrofon? Sonst gebe ich meins mal ab.
Ja, hallo. Jan Hindal von der Firma Satex. Ich hätte eine Frage. Sie haben es angesprochen mit den Sustainability-Nachfragen von OEMs. Zeichnet sich da schon ab, ob es da Standards so gibt, wie sowas in Zukunft berechnet werden soll? Sehen Sie da Trends in der Richtung?
Also es gibt bisher da noch keine Standards. Wir haben das einfach, der Vorreiter war in dem Fall einmal der größte deutsche OEM, der da sich an die Spitze gestellt hat, aber auch Daimler, BMW sind da nachgezogen. Das ist jetzt noch in der Entwicklung, wie das überprüft werden soll. Im Moment ist man, was Sustainability anbelangt, noch in einer Urfindungsphase, ich sage das jetzt mal so. Aber man möchte genau wissen, wo kommt das her. Und da hat eigentlich auch der Lockdown im letzten Jahr die OEMs aus einem anderen Grund noch sehr sensibilisiert. Da passierte es nämlich so, dass bei ein bestimmter OEM zwar 3 Zulieferer hatte, 3 Tier 1s. Alle 3 Tier 1s haben aber bei der gleichen Gießerei in Norditalien ihr Vorprodukt bezogen. Und wie dann der Brenner dicht war, sowohl für Schiene als auch für Straße, und da nichts kam, auch der Lockdown in den Firmen dort war, dann hatten die plötzlich ein Problem. Da nützten auch 3 verschiedene Tier 1s nicht. Und da hat man auch gesagt, wir wollen A sehen, uns offenlegen lassen, wo bezieht unser Tier 1 seine Vormaterialien her. Und heute kommt mehr und mehr dazu, wie nachhaltig ist es produziert. Aber der Nachweis der Nachhaltigkeit, wie sich das langfristig einspielen wird, das wird ein wesentlicher Prozess die nächsten 2-3 Jahre sein. Da werden Sie auch als Zulieferer gefordert werden, über Ihre Mitglieder im VDA, beispielsweise wenn es um die Automobilindustrie geht. Im Maschinenbau ist das noch nicht so weit, aber auch da wird es vielleicht irgendwann kommen. Aber gerade in der Automobilindustrie wird man da auch im Rohstoffausschuss des VDA gefordert sein. Denn das wäre eigentlich für mich das Gremium, was dort die Nachhaltigkeitskette einmal ein bisschen strukturieren müsste.
Vielen Dank. Vielen Dank. Haben wir Fragen aus dem Netz? Okay, gut. Prima. Dann, Herr Büchner, Herr Netz, vielen Dank für Ihre Ausführungen. Und wir haben spannende Zeiten vor uns. Dann hoffen wir mal auf die zweite Hälfte 2022. Da sieht ja alles ein bisschen rosiger aus. Schauen wir mal.
Da sind wir ganz optimistisch.
Prima.
Dankeschön.
Dankeschön und einen Applaus für Sie. Danke.